गुड डे, दिस इज मनोज काबरे, वाइस प्रेसिडेंट सेल्स एंड मार्केटिंग फ्रॉम इंडोमिम. वी आर द वर्ल्ड्स लार्जेस्ट कंपनी एंगेज्ड इनटू अ वेरी यूनिक एंड इमर्जिंग टेक्नोलॉजी कॉल्ड मेटल इंजेक्शन मोल्डिंग. एंड इन एडिशन टू दैट, ओवर द लास्ट फ्यू ईयर्स वी हैव ऑल्सो स्टार्टेड मेटल पाउडर प्रोडक्शन. And today I'm going to discuss with you more related to the metal powders for additive manufacturing, which is something which is catching up a lot. So friends, in the content, we're going to talk about the introduction, the metal powder production techniques, the facility for metal powder production. That's the one which is at Indomim. We are one of the only company having this kind of unique powder production facility. We also talk about Indomim metal powders, that is what kind of metal powders are being used at Indomim, you know. So we talk about that. We talk about qualification and controls at Indomim for metal powders, and we talk about metal powders for mega drivers. Right, so what are the main areas where these metal powders for additive manufacturing have been really catching up? What does the scenario in the industrial market look like? And of course, we talk about our core technology, metal injection molding, before we close for the day. So I hope this kind of content is aligned to your expectations. So let me commence the introduction. So Indomim is a metal injection molding company, and metal injection molding is one of the branches of powder metallurgy, as few of you might know. We have one of the largest facility in the world to make MIM components, and we have global market share of roughly about 14%. Actually, this entire market of metal injection molding is very, very scattered, you know. So it has a very, very long tail, if I may say so. And we are, of course, the world number one, and world number two is roughly about one third of our size. And then, of course, you have a lot of other companies. There are roughly about 100 companies in China. There are about 50 odd companies in Japan, you know, similar number in Europe, and so on. Indomim has three manufacturing locations in India. Two for metal injection molding and one for investment casting. And we started about 3 years back also a greenfield metal injection molding plant in USA. We, as I mentioned earlier, are the first Indian company to install a commercial scale hot gas atomizer. This was done about 4 years back in 2006 in Bangalore at our Doddaballapur facility. Let's focus some time on metal powder production techniques, because I'm sure all of you might be curious as to what kind of metal powder production techniques are used, what are their merits, what are their demerits, why are there multiple metal powder production techniques. So I mean, one thing which all of you probably might be able to visualize or imagine is a mechanical processing, or you also call it milling or grinding of powders, right? Now, mechanical processing provides irregular shape. And this is something which is used where quality is not of prime importance, you know. Simple examples that I could cite would be gas cutting or welding application, you know. So this is something which is used for mechanical application. And aluminium powder, which is subjected to mechanical milling, is also used in cracking application. So that's another application for that. Predominantly, mechanical processing is something which is used where quality is not of paramount importance, and where scale is of importance. So mainly, I would say it is mainly for general applications, right? The second technique, which is pretty popular, is called pyrolysis, or I would say carbonyl decomposition and electro deposition. This is used mainly for powder size less than 10 microns. Right, so food industries, iron vitamins, industrial applications, these are some of the applications. And then, you know, you have basically iron powder by, sorry, molybdenum, which has a melting point of about 2700 degrees centigrade. So that's some powder where high melting point is one of the prerequisite for getting into carbonyl or electrodeposition or reduction technique. Tungsten might be another example, which also has a high melting point, and then the carbonyl route is something which is used for production of such powders. And then the other thing that you do in atomization, and the other technique that you do very popular, is called atomization, which is mainly for bulk or cost-effective production. And within atomization, there are two types. One is water atomization and another one is gas atomization. So water atomization is something which is pretty popular, and again, a simple example could be iron powder. You know, iron powder, which is usually made by water atomization, where of course you get irregular shape in water atomization. You get basically you have to do additional operations like dewatering, like drying, which of course consumes some time. But ultimately, you end up spending a lot less amount of expenditure as compared to gas atomization, right? So water atomization is a technique that produces a bit of irregular shape, and it again can be used for areas where oxygen content or nitrogen content is not very, very important, right? So what is happening here is that there is a pickup of oxygen and nitrogen content, you know, from water, or even hydrogen content from water. And that's something which remains in the powder when you use a water atomization technique, right? So these basically, I can call these as impurities, presence of water, presence of oxygen and nitrogen. And the applications of water atomization, typically iron, are areas where you may not want these impurities to be below a threshold level of a few ppm, right? The technique which Indomim has been focusing on is called gas atomization. And gas atomization is predominantly a technique where you would have these ppms of all, you know, hydrogen, oxygen, nitrogen to be below something like 100 ppm. I mean, there are techniques available where you can even control them below 100 ppm. And there are various applications, starting from aerospace or starting from medical devices or even oil and gas sectors, where these kind of gas atomization techniques or production methodology is used, because you have a very, very clear focus on controlling the ppm levels of these impurities, because these are going to affect the end product quality in a direct way. So at Indomim, we have been focusing on utilizing this gas atomization process, as well as further perfecting it, you know, such that we are able to give the product of quality as required by these demanding industries. So delving a little bit further in the gas atomization process, which is widely adopted, you know, it can be, the gas atomization process can be implemented, or the production can be done using two specific methods. One is called vacuum induction melting, plus inert gas, of course, and electrode or plasma melting, as it is also called, plus inert gas atmosphere. So basically, we have inert gas as an important element in both these processes. But the specific discrimination, as you can see on this slide, between these two processes is that one is using a crucible, whereas second is not using crucible, right? So vacuum induction melting is something which is one of the most popular method that is used for producing most of the alloy steels, stainless steels, nickel and cobalt super alloys. It's basically a process whereby you have a crucible into which this particular molten metal is poured, and the crucible is mainly having some amount of silica or aluminium oxide, which probably would get mixed up with the molten metal, thereby because of, you know, there is some gas which gets eroded and mixed, And these are some of the inclusions which may be present inside the molten metal while it is getting atomized. And it can certainly achieve a aerograde purity level, but not to the, I mean, I would say about 70% of the applications of aerospace would be utilizing this kind of vacuum induction melted gas atomization process. Whereas some of the demanding applications, probably 25 to 30% might not be able to use the product out of vacuum induction melting. And also it is not suitable for reactive metals, right? So in summary, vacuum induction melting has a crucible. It enables some of the impurities or, you know, the parent material of crucible to be mixed along with molten metals while it is being, the melted metal is being poured. And it is used for about 70% of the aerospace applications. Coming to electrode or plasma melting, again here, as I said, it has inert gas and it is termed as a ceramic-free melting process. It's used mainly for refractive metals. The simplest thing here is that the inclusions which normally come because of the presence of crucible are going to be absent here. And that clearly indicates that you would not have impurities, and hence the population of spherical powder is going to be more. Certainly this is an expensive route, but then, you know, if you have any conventional alloys also to be produced here because of this purity content or because of this higher population of spherical powders, it is definitely preferred. The highlight here is that the electrode that itself acts as a crucible here, right? So there is no formal ceramic crucible that is used here since it is a ceramic free melting process, but the electrode itself acts as a crucible and the melting process takes place using this plasma. So let's come to the hot gas atomization process flow. So this slide briefly explains you the process flow that is being implemented at Indomem. So we have basically the 7-step process which is given in this flow chart. The first, as you would obviously understand or appreciate, is incoming inspection. So the raw material is coming into the plant. There is a formal way of incoming inspection which is done. The second process is melting, right? So melting is where the molten metal is poured, and this we have something called a tundish process, whereby there is a large vessel in which there is a small orifice at the end. So it will be poured from the crucible into this tundish, and this allows the flowability of the molten metal through this small orifice, about 6 mm or so, before it goes for the atomization process. Now friends, what happens in atomization process is that there is a gas which flows at a velocity of something like 1 or 1.5 Mach, right, 300 meters per second or something, and under that high pressure, when this 6 mm orifice is leading some hot molten metal into the large vessel, that's where this atomization takes place. So the facilitation of atomization is taken place through the high velocity of the inert gas, right? And once the atomization is done, what you have as a result of it is probably particles less than 5 microns going up to about 150, 200 microns, you know. So it's a very, very wide array of particles that would come as a result of atomization. So necessarily what we need to do is we need to screen them, right? The next process is screening. So what do you mean by screening? Screening is basically classification of these powders into different size levels. So we have, for instance, less than 20 microns, which is used for metal injection molding. 20 to 50 microns is used for some of these additive manufacturing processes. The most popular band for additive manufacturing is 50 to 150 microns. And of course, beyond 150 microns is used for other processes. So the major powder that is being used is between this, 0 to 150 microns. And that's something which is done through this screening process. Subsequent to that, we have blending process, again, where our team has done some wonderful work of establishing fine processes that enables us to have very good blending, right? Which subsequently goes to the quality check. So quality assurance is the area where we do this quality check. So we have various in-process inspection stages while we go through these processes. But of course, quality check at the end of the completion of blending is something which is done before we pack these products into predetermined boxes or predetermined packaging sizes. So here is an image of the large scale hot gas atomizer that's available at Indomim. We have a melt capacity of about 600 tons per annum, and this is of course vacuum melting or hot inert nitrogen gas atomization process. I will talk about ASB features, anti-satellite features that our team has wonderfully worked along with the supplier to have this kind of feature. That is mainly helping us to have very good powder sphericity. And on additive manufacturing, we are focusing a lot. Currently, we have about 100 tons of capacity dedicated for additive manufacturing out of the 600 tons that we have. And we are planning to enhance this capacity to roughly about 300 tons per annum by the year 2022. Currently, we are able to handle ferrous alloys, nickel and cobalt super alloy powders, and we certainly plan to get into new and new varieties of powders based on the demands from our additive manufacturing folks across the country as well as internationally. I'm very pleased to say at this stage that majority of additive manufacturing shops in the country today have switched over to Indomim powders, and they are pretty happy and pleased with the performance of our team, both the technical as well as the commercial team. I mean, just to say that the pricing-wise, we are competitive, and we are also able to support most of these additive manufacturing shops with respect to specific powders that they need, with respect to R&D efforts that they need. Many times, they need specific controls on flow rate at their end. So, to enhance the print quality, we have been able to do a good work with respect to providing them the right technical support in terms of a powder manufacturer. So, expanding further, when we talk about the powder requirements, as you all know, there are multiple additive manufacturing processes starting from DMLS, EBM, DED, right? Majority of them. And then, of course, we make powders for metal injection molding as well as binder jetting and press and sinter. Press and sinter is the routine powder metallurgy age-old process. So, in the second row, friends, you can see the particle size distribution in microns that is given for all these different kinds of processes. For instance, DMLS, direct metal laser sintering, uses 15 to 50 microns. EBM, electron beam, uses 50 to 150 microns. Same is the range of particle size distribution used for DED. Metal injection molding, as I said earlier, uses less than 20 microns, so roughly about 4 to 22 microns. And binder jetting is another very interesting process that Indomim has got into in the last 18 months or so, where again the powder size that is used is about 5 to 25 microns or going up to 40 microns in critical cases. Beyond 40 microns, that is from 45 to 180 microns, is something which is used for press and sinter. So the third row, as you can see, is about the particle shape. So majority of additive manufacturing requires a spherical shape. That's one of the important requirements for having a better printing quality. Whereas metal injection molding uses spherical or irregular shape. You need to have a combination of these shapes. That is something which enables you to have a better packing in metal injection molding. Binder jetting also requires spherical shape. And of course, in coming to press and sinter, you have combination of spherical and irregular shapes. Size distribution width is something which I would like to draw attention from all of you. That is the fourth row, which clearly highlights what kind of size distribution width is something which is used for various additive manufacturing processes as well as metal injection molding, binder jetting, and press and sinter process. So you would see that typically additive manufacturing oscillates between about 1.34 to 1.38 as far as the size distribution width is concerned. Whereas when we go to metal injection molding, it is reasonably higher, 1.75. Binder jetting again going higher to 1.83. And of course, the the presence inter uses about 2.02 as the process, you know, or the size of by distribution width, that is 2.02. So I would draw your attention to this size distribution width, because this is something which additive manufacturing focuses on. So typically for additive manufacturing, we need a little, I would say, narrow distribution that directly affects the print quality. So you can see in this chart that 1.34 to 1.38 is the size distribution width that has been used for additive manufacturing, right? Again, to highlight a little further, in case of metal injection molding, you have a higher size distribution width. Again, there is a reason for it, because by having this, you are able to have a better, I would say, packing in terms of molding process and other things. And binder jetting, if you would know, is also very similar to metal injection molding, just that the molding element of metal injection molding gets replaced with printing in case of binder jetting, whereas the debinding and sintering processes that I will explain a little further when I go to metal injection molding is also present in binder jetting. Challenges in the AM industry. I think all of you probably are aware that additive manufacturing is certainly going through a lot of difficult times. I mean, it was definite. There was definitely a hype about additive manufacturing catching up very quick. But then there are mainly these four challenges which are mainly affecting most of the job shops or 3D printing shops. High cost, lack of experience, feedstock, complex design. Right, so these are the main four things which are going to be affecting the growth of additive manufacturing industry. When we say high cost, it is basically because of low productivity, as you would all know or probably imagine. The other reason also for high cost is scrap from failed prints. So basically the yield that is coming out of additive manufacturing process is not very good owing to the failed prints. And the second important thing is the setup time. So these are the three main elements which are contributing to high cost in the additive manufacturing process. I mean, it's a relatively new technology. I'm sure all of you know that additive manufacturing is not very old in terms of technology, although there has been a lot of research going on, especially in the West. And the second important area why additive manufacturing is struggling owing to the factor of lack of experience is the challenging part. I mean, I'm sure you know that aerospace is something, or oil and gas are two industries which are trying to utilize, or I would say exploit, the additive manufacturing technology to a very large extent. And hence, most of the designers are being allowed to make as much challenging part design as possible. And most of the additive manufacturing shops are having difficulty in producing these part designs. So these challenging part designs are one of the reasons that is causing the additive manufacturing shops not to be quite successful. That's of course acting as a challenge. Feedstock. This is another area which is an important challenge, but mainly being focused by Indomem, our company. There are limited ranges, as you would know, in terms of feedstock. The controls in feedstock properties is something which is critical, mainly with respect to achieving repeatability. I would come a little further on talking more about how Indomem has really focused more on getting this feedstock thing done. And we have been able to support, of course, our own captive requirement as well as most of the customers. The fourth and final challenge in AM industry is of complex design. So basically, we have difficulty in finishing the parts. Most of you would know that additive manufacturing does not give a very good surface finish. So we need to necessarily have a post additive manufacturing finishing process. The support structure removal is an element which has to be necessarily done irrespective of what kind of additive manufacturing process we do. And of course, inspection is an important element that takes up a lot of time. So these are the three parameters under the complex design category that is acting as a challenge to the AM industry. So, having briefly discussed about these points, let me now talk about Indomim metal powders, as to what kind of metal powders Indomim is specifically focusing on, what are the powders that we have included in our basket. So, we have basically four categories or four basic heads under which we are manufacturing powders and supplying to the additive manufacturing industry. One is stainless steel, where we have almost all the major fast-moving stainless steel items under this particular group: SS316L, 174PH, 155PH, SS304, SS321, SS310, and martensitic stainless steel SS420. So these are the main fast-moving stainless steels that we are producing regularly, and we have stocks of these powders at all points of time. When we come to alloy steel, we have been making MA300, H13, tool steels like M2 and D2. We make bearing steel 50 to 100 and we also make 4 to 40. So these are the alloy steels, again based on the research that our sales and marketing team has done with respect to what kind of powders are required in the market. These kind of items have been used. Nickel alloys is something which is one of the fast moving product categories at Indomim, mainly used by aerospace applications as well as some of the oil and gas applications. So IN Inconel 718, Inconel 713C, Inconel 625, and one of the very popular method or popular powder that we have made is called Nymonic 90. So these are the four categories of nickel alloys that we are making. Coming to cobalt alloys, T400, T800, these are the commercial names that we are doing. These are high cobalt powders, mainly used for high temperature applications. We are using F75 also as one of the powders, high cobalt chromium, which is used for medical grade. We do produce Stellite 6, and of course we are producing Haynes 25 also. So these are the four broad categories of powders that we are making, and I have also narrated all the specific names of the powders. So this is something which will help you to remember the variety of these powders. But of course, producing powders is just not enough. What is important is qualification and controls. So let me take some time and explain to you what kind of qualifications and controls are available at Indomim. So in brief, these are the four primary characteristics as well as the four secondary characteristics that are being controlled at Indomim. What you would see is that the primary characteristics are particle sizes and distribution, particle shape, chemical composition, and particle density. So these are the four primary characteristics that Indomim focuses on, which in turn helps us to control the apparent or bulk density, flow rate, tap density, as well as compressibility and grain strength. So as you would appreciate that the quality control is something which is important for us to get the powder to the additive manufacturing folks, whereby they are able to utilize them in a better way. And the properties which are listed down here, these are something which are the minimum for these additive manufacturing folks to be able to use this powder and have lower failed print rates. Now what we are doing at Indomim is that we are fine-tuning our process design. We are continuously iterating the process and having better controls so as to have all these particle shapes and distribution, particle density, that enables us to have mainly better tap density and flow rate. So flow rate is something which is an important secondary characteristic that directly affects the printer, I would say. And the in-house process capability measures that we have adopted, that is something which is helping us bring a better control in terms of powder consistency. I have also included in the presentation some of the control charts, which will have you proof of the pudding is in eating kind of concept, whereby you are able to see what kind of controls are actually being given out at Indomim batch after batch. The particle size distribution and morphology indirectly controls the apparent density and flow rate, as I was mentioning earlier. So just to kind of give you a kind of a thumb rule, so if there is a good powder, what would happen is you pick up like 50 grams of powder, pass it through an orifice of say 1 inch, it should take less than 20 seconds to flow, right? So this is one of the easiest or benchmark kind of method by which you are able to understand if the flow rate of the powder is good and if it's going to be helpful for the printing platform, right? So I was mentioning about these controls. So here are some of the particle size distribution control charts. In the upper chart, you see D10 in microns, and what you are seeing there is the blue one, which is the lower specification limit. The orange one is the upper specification limit, and at the center is the D10 control on particle size distribution, starting from batch number 1 to batch number 17. So what is controlled at IndoMEM in terms of the process parameters is what is reflecting here in terms of result, right? So well within the upper and lower specification limit. Same thing you can see in the D50 fraction trend. Again, the blue is the lower specification limit, orange is the upper specification limit, and the D50 line, as you can see, or trend, as you can see from batch 1 to batch 17, we've just taken some example here that shows you that the output is very much in control within the upper and the lower limit. Here you have the controls on PSD for D90 fraction trend. So again, you can see between the lower and upper specification limit, D90 is pretty consistent, pretty low in terms of the variation. And the last one is D99, where of course there is only upper specification limit, and again D99 is pretty much controlled. When we talk about powder's particle size distribution trends, it is important to have these checked, you know, the powder properties to be checked. So these are some of the popular methods that are being used by the industry, starting from dynamic image analysis, static image analysis, sieve analysis, laser diffraction, and dynamic light scattering. So you can see on the right side, against each of these methods, we have also given the range for this particle size distribution. For instance, for dynamic image analysis, it is 0.8 microns to 135 microns. For laser diffraction, it is about 10 nanometers to 5 mm. I mean, we at IndoMEM, of course, use laser diffraction. On the right side, you can see the Master Sizer 3000 Malvern. That's the instrument that we use. Of course, we control from about 1 micron, starting from 1 micron upwards, using this laser diffraction method. But just out of academic perspective, I thought we should include these different methodologies as well as the range that they can qualify or that they can check, you know. So having talked about the particle size distribution or the methodologies to check them, powder properties and all, I think it's time for us to switch over the gears to particle shape. This is another important parameter that needs to be controlled when we come to additive manufacturing. And what does particle shape play in terms of role? So it has a very significant role in powder metallurgy, whether it is additive manufacturing or metal injection molding. And shape is basically decided based on the application. If you remember early on, I just mentioned briefly that additive manufacturing needs spherical shape for having a better printing quality, whereas metal injection molding, wherein you mix the powders along with the binders and you need something called green strength, you know, there you need a very good combination of irregular shape as well as the spherical shape. So the particle shape is going to be one of the main parameters, I would say, which is going to affect the process. And in case of metal injection molding, the way it would be optimized is that it would enable dense packing to be done by having this kind of combination, right? Powder properties, again, now focusing on this ASB, that's a feature that IndoMEM has jointly developed with our supplier, so anti-satellite blur. So what does this mean? This basically means that it is a feature that minimizes the satellite formation. Now, what is a satellite formation? As the word says, it's basically small particles which are kind of clung on to the large particles, right? So this is what is called satellite. So obviously you would be able to visualize that these small particles which are clung on to the large particles, they would act as friction, right? So because of friction, what would happen is that it would cause it would become a deterrent to the flowability during the printing, right? So anti-satellite blower is a feature available in the process, manufacturing process, that allows you to make the printing quality better, right? So you would not have friction on these smaller particles that are clung onto the major particles, and that's how you would have a better flow rate and hence a better printing quality, right? So the properties that are going to be affected in a ASB anti-satellite blower kind of powder are going to be superior as compared to the no ASB kind of powder criteria. On the right side in the screen, you can see on the top, we have given a micrograph of no ASB, and on the bottom, you can see a micrograph of ASB operated powder output. And the schematic of this ASB anti-satellite blower is shown on the left side. We have also taken a small photograph of the actual anti-satellite blower happening inside the atomization process, just to make you understand what exactly is this particular feature. Coming to different measurement techniques, when we talk about the particle shape, electron microscope, shape analyzer for circularity, and Hall flow apparatus for checking the flow. These are the three different measurement techniques that are being used. Hausner ratio and Carr index, I'm sure most of you would be familiar by these parameters, and this is something which are the parameters that are used to basically designate the flowability of the powder. So good flow would be less than 1.2 Hausner ratio, moderate would be 1.2 to 1.3, and of course poor flow will be more than 1.3. again, on the Carr index, you would have good flow less than 18, moderate would be 18 to 22, and poor flow would be more than 23. I'm sorry for the small typo there. Coming to angle of repose, this is another parameter that is being used for the particle shape. I hope everyone is able to follow this particular thing as of now, and we'll try to go to little more details as we go into the next slides. Powder properties, chemical composition. So this is the slide which gives you details about the equipment that we are using for checking the particle size distribution, for checking the tap density, for true density, as well as the particle size distribution and apparent density. So these are the instruments that we are using, and the reference test standards are given there. So as you would know that MPIF, Metal Powder Industries Federation, that has a standard. And of course, aligning with ASTM, and these ASTM and MPIF standard is something which we are using as a reference for checking all these properties using the equipment that you are seeing on the slide. Here are some reports or some trend charts to highlight the controls established at Indomim on chemistry. So these are the results in ppm, as you can see. And we are giving the O2 in ppm on the top chart, and the bottom chart shows you the nitrogen in ppm, right? So very good controls on the O2 and nitrogen, and you have the upper specification limits for both oxygen and nitrogen, and at Indomim we are able to sufficiently control these well below the upper specification limit. I mean, needless to say, the lower the better. But again, if you want to have a better control on oxygen and nitrogen, certainly you need to have a higher manufacturing cost, right? That brings us to the next important topic, that is true density, right? So which is also a measure of the porosity present in the powder. So true density is something which we measure using an instrument called picometer. And on the left side, you can see these requirements. Usually it is preferred to have greater than 97% of theoretical density. And for that, what the controls that are available at Indomim are 3C plus 2C plus 1C, that is the inspection of materials at different stages. So let me explain a bit about the 3C, right? So our raw material supplier, they would, of course, we would go and audit them or do a pre-qualification for them. That would be the first C. The second C would be the reports or the samples that they would send us for every melt that they're going to send it to us, right? So we would have, we would maintain records for that. That's the second C. And the third C is the raw material inspection that we would do upon the arrival of powder. So if you recall, when I was explaining the process flow for the powder manufacturing, I was showing you that the in-process inspection is something which happens at Indomem for every arriving batch, right? So that's the third C that is being done. Now, when we come to 2C, this is basically the process inspection that is being done, in-process inspection and the final inspection that is being done. And 1C is the final inspection that is being done before the dispatch of the powder to our customer. So another requirement is that based on the application, the controls must be exerted not to exceed the theoretical density. So this is one of the important parameter. So what we do is we optimize the atomization parameter to ensure that the internal porosity is eliminated, right, to a large extent. So true density, as I said, is a measure of how much porosity, internal porosity is available. Every powder has certain internal porosity. And for us to assess how much of this internal porosity is available, we check the true density using this pycnometer, right? Now, coming to the study on the printed specimen, what we do is we study the metal powders compatibility with printers. The tensile specimens are printed as per the ISO 6892 standard, which is of course equivalent to the ASTM standard given here. So then these printed specimens are tested for hardness, porosity and tensile properties. All the specimens are printed in US. I mean, our team has really taken good lead in having a wonderful collaboration with EOS, which is the world's largest company for making these printers. So we have identified a specific machine, M280, on which all these printed specimens are tested. And this kind of collaboration between Indomem and US is something which is standardized, and that is something which is followed for powder qualification process. This enables us to have a standardized thing. So what we have done is we have taken Inconel 718, we have taken SS316L, we have taken Maraging Steel and 174PH. These are the four powders that we have taken for study, and we carried out these studies with the printer basically to assess how good are the mechanical properties compared to conventional processed materials and the standard values of the printed specimens from the other manufacturers. Right, so unless you benchmark, I'm sure you would agree that it is very, very difficult for you to, you know, indicate your USP. So powders for mega drivers, everything, we have talked about the powders, we have talked about the manufacturing process, but it's also important to identify or to correlate this powder production with respect to the industry. Of course, all of you are from academic background, but there are, I'm sure, some people in the audience who are also from the industry side. So you would be certainly curious to know that what are the materials for the emerging markets? So what kind of applications are coming up in the coming years, and where exactly is the industry delving so as to help us, people like us who are powder manufacturers, to be able to catch up with the upcoming requirements and thereby support. So when we come to high temperature applications, these are the ones that you can see are clearly emerging. On the high temperature applications, aerospace, you know, that's one of the areas that is certainly demanding for this. Coming to pharma, food, chemicals and fertilizer industries, again, there are very, very specific and niche requirements that are helping us to identify these things and develop the specific powders. And soft magnets, I mean, EV, as you all know, is something which is an emerging application, which is catching up very fast, both on the two-wheeler as well as the four-wheeler side. And EV is demanding a lot of support from the powder manufacturers. And so we are doing a lot of activity for the EV as well. So let's go into all these specific market applications one by one. So here are the four major alloys that we have developed for applications from the HTA, high temperature applications, which spans across the industries of manufacturers like turbocharger manufacturers, like people who manufacture sleeves, hot working tool, turbine blade, combustor, and these kind of applications. So when we come to cobalt 400 and 800, good galling and wear resistance at high temperatures is something which is required more than 850 degrees centigrade. This powder is a good candidate for non-lubricant high temperature rotating parts. And adequate corrosion resistance and weldability is something which is important for this powder, which is one of the key characteristics. When we come to Nymonic 90, nickel, chromium and cobalt alloys, this is something which is the hallmark of Nymonic 90. It has a good stress rupture strength up to about 920 degrees centigrade. So turbochargers are ones which are using this particular materials to a large extent. It has a tensile strength of about 350 megapascals at about 900 degrees centigrade. So this is something which is very unique for Nymonic 90. Coming to Udimet or Haynes 188, this is again a cobalt chrome nickel tungsten alloy, which has an excellent sulfidation and oxidation resistance up to about 1050 degrees centigrade. And it has a very, very strong metallurgical stability. Some of the other alloys that we have been developing for these markets are Inconel HX, Buspalloy, and MAR-M. Coming to chemical industries, or I would say also pharma industries, which can be covered in this category, the three main materials that we are developing here is Hestalloy C26, Incoloy 825, and Haynes 25. Nickel chromium molybdenum alloys with excellent corrosion resistance is the hallmark for C276 of Hestalloy. It's resistant to chloride gas and hypochlorite. So any application that demands these kind of resistance can definitely use this kind of material. It's also resistant to brine solutions and mineral acids, right? And of course, needless to say, it's weldable and resistant to SCC. The second alloy is nickel chromium iron molybdenum alloy. It again has excellent corrosion resistance and to oxidizing and reducing acids. It has good resistance to SCC, pitting and crevice corrosion, and also good resistant to sulfuric and phosphoric acid, right? So we have also shown some of the images at the bottom of these specific materials. Haynes 25 is a cobalt nickel chromium tungsten alloy with good high temperature oxidation resistance, also good high temperature strength and resistance to sulfidation. So based on these properties for these specific materials, the industries can select. And there's a lot of support that Indomem engineers are providing to the industry in terms of understanding the requirements and tailoring our processes to get these kind of parts for the specific industry. Here are some of the images of additive manufacturing parts. I mean, we have also, thanks to our partner industry from the 3D printing, who helped us to get these images, courtesy. Application is exhaust tube, as you see at the top left, which is material of SS316L. There's another application of conformal cooling channel in material MS1 that has been done using 3D printing. The third one you can see in the sequence is chassis frame for a two-wheeler. It's a pretty large component in 316 that we have made, that we have helped make to additive manufacturing. There are other chassis frame child parts which are made on the fourth one. And then you have a strainer for compressor and tooling insert, I mean, that this particular additive manufacturing company is making for us, for our own captive consumption. So the reason I thought we should include these images of additive manufacturing parts are, these are the kind of parts that are used by the powder that we are supplying, or they are printed by the powder we are supplying. Here are some more classified images, as per the industry. These are the images for instance, for two-wheeler segment, as you can see from the end images of representative images of motorcycles, that these are parts which go for specific to two-wheeler industry, and again spanning across various materials and spanning across various shapes. Here are the applications of aerospace. We are making powders which are being used to make VTM brackets as well as the impeller, open impellers. As you can see, the image of open impeller material is SS316. shape is pretty complex, right? And making such kind of impellers through conventional processes is going to be very, very tough. Using machining, you can take ages and hours and days to make these kind of products. So additive manufacturing is certainly the best process which is suitable for these kind of components for aerospace industry. And in general, aerospace industry has shown very good acceptance for AM parts. Having talked about additive manufacturing in detail, I think time has come for me to also touch upon metal injection molding. That's one of the process which is at the core of Indomim. As I said, we are the world's largest company engaged into making this metal injection molding process. So friends, metal injection molding is a process that has the best of both worlds. One of the world called powder metallurgy and another world called plastic injection molding. So what we have done, what this process has done, metal injection molding, is he has picked up the alloying benefits from powder metallurgy, and it has picked up the shape making benefits or shape making capability feature of plastic injection molding, and it has evolved as a process that has best of both these worlds. So MIM, as we call it as an abbreviation, MIM is a four-step process starting from compounding to injection molding, followed by debinding and sintering. So what is compounding? Compounding is basically a process where we mix the metal powders that are produced by atomization process, gas and water atomization. And these are mixed with binders, right? So we have four different components of binders that we use to mix along with the metal powders, and then feedstock is made, right? So in the image, you see white color is the binder, representative binder, black color is the powder, and on the farther end, you see the feedstock, which is very similar to plastic injection molding granules. Just that here, it has a mixture of metal powders and binders. So the feedstock is something which is injected into the mold at the injection molding stage. And that is something which gives us the green part. So you can see an image of the green part. Now this green part has the entire shape or contour of the part that you as a customer intend to have. However, the part is oversized. The reason I say oversized is it has content of binder in it, right? So what would happen necessarily in the next two stages is that we would have debinding and sintering do the removal of binders, right? So the first major component of binder, which is basically called the primary binder, is removed at the debinding, solvent debinding stage. And the remaining, at this stage, we call the output as brown part. And the remaining component binder, secondary component binder, is still with the component holding the metal particles together. At this stage, we put the part to sintering. Now, inside the sintering furnace, we have two types of furnaces, vacuum furnace as well as continuous furnace. Here, the first stage of the process is called thermal debinding, wherein we allow the secondary binders to evaporate, right? And with the completion of evaporation of these secondary binders starts the intermolecular diffusion, or which we also call as sintering. Now, friends, you can see in the image here that the sintered part seems to be far smaller than the green part or the brown part, right? And this is indicative of the 20% shrinkage that occurs in the sintering process. So why does 20% shrinkage happen? The intermolecular diffusion that happens inside the sintering furnace is the main reason why 20% shrinkage occurs, and this gives the density to the product. So what we say usually is that metal injection molding is a process that enables you to get complex shaped parts with full strength, which means there is no compromise on strength, but still you are having a metal forming process produce it. You are not doing metal cutting. And in simple things, if I can tell you, metal cutting is something which enables production of burr, right? So MIM process is a metal forming process that eliminates the production of burr itself. So that's one of the very, very important deterrent that any manufacturing shop floor fellow would kind of be worried about. That's something which is completely absent here in metal injection molding, owing to the way this process is designed. So here is an example, for you to understand what kind of complexity are we talking about. Indomim, the tagline is complexity simplified, right? So when we say complexity simplified, what kind of complexity are we talking about? So on the left side, you can see it's an 8-step process for a component that you see, of course, on the last etch stage. That's the finished part, right? So this is basically a steel part used for an automotive application for fuel control or fuel flow control, I would say. So starting from A to H are the specific processes that were being used to manufacture this particular component using the conventional manufacturing technology, right? So A is the cylindrical tube, B is the machined blank profile, C is the gear profile machining, when they're followed by slot cutting, chamfer on the legs and ID, followed by counter drilling and reaming, tapping, and finally the finished part. Now to have all these features on the component, if you can see on the right side, metal injection molding just uses a very simple molding step, which gives the entire profile, entire form. Yeah? And here you have a single drop that is shown, single drop of the hot runner that's shown. We have a 8-cavity or a 16-cavity mold for this particular component. And the beauty is that the entire feedstock flows inside the mold, which has been designed and manufacturing ahead of time to get this entire profile incorporated onto the component, right? Including the internal thread, as you can see there. Then subsequently, as I said in the earlier slide, it is taken through the debinding and sintering process, where you get the intermolecular diffusion and the densification of the part. So you are able to get all these 8 steps eliminated and convert that into a single process called metal injection molding. This specific component is just finished at the metal injection molding without the need of any post-MIM secondary process, right? Now, what kind of applications or what kind of windows of opportunities does metal injection molding offer? So here is a slide that gives you productivity on the y-axis, which means the quantity that you need annually, and part complexity on the x-axis, where we are spanning the complexity right from low to medium, high, and going to very high. So if you can see, low part complexity and high volume is something which is the domain of presencing or powder metallurgy, right? If the volume is less, that means the quantities are less, whereas the part complexity is medium or high, you would end up using investment casting. And if the medium to high complexity is available for the part, as well as the productivity is high or the quantity is high, that's when you end up using metal injection molding. So basically, we are talking about complexity as the prerequisite for metal injection molding to be favorable. The yet another new emerging technology called binder jet technology is something which Indomium has really got into. And that is for the area of high or very high complexity with low volumes. As I briefly mentioned, that binder jet technology also uses more or less similar process flow like metal injection molding, just that the molding process is replaced by a printing process, right? So typically the applications for metal injection molding, I would say 80% applications across the world are less than 50 grams part weight. So typically metal injection molded parts are the ones which you can hold in your palm, you know, 4 to 5 parts you can hold in your palm. Very, very small parts, 10 grams, 15 grams. That's a weight range of metal injection molded parts. But most of these parts would have at least about 25 to 30 measurable dimensions or critical dimensions on the component drawing. So that's a very, very easier way of identifying a part favorable for metal injection molding. Right? So Indomium offers an integrated value chain, starting from metal injection molding to ceramic injection molding, investment casting, precision machining, special processes, and metal binder jet 3D printing. So we are basically a one-stop solution provider who is able to offer all these solutions for all of our global customers. 92% of our sales is exports, and Indomium is a very popular and very credible name to reckon with across the globe in the manufacturing space, whereby we are able to cover a very, very wide scope of industries through these particular technologies. And customer is God for Indomium. And that is the reason you can see on this slide, the global presence, in addition to our manufacturing footprints, which are shown through blue arrows, we also have sales offices as well as sales representatives all over the world. We have sales offices in USA, in Germany, and in China. In addition to that, we have sales representatives in majority of the non-English speaking regions, you know, where we need people who are native to that those countries, who are able to converse or interact with the customers and get them the service. So the whole objective here is that we should be able to take the technology to the customer's doorsteps. That's the objective of Indomem in having such a wide kind of scale. So that's all from my side. Our whole objective is partnering our skill with your innovative minds to engineer value. This is a pre-recorded session, so I'm not sure if we are able to have any questions or interactions here. But nevertheless, you can definitely post your questions to the organizing team, and we can certainly get you the answers. If you have any suggestions for us, any ideas, any areas where you want Indomem additive manufacturing powder plant to partner with you or to give you additional expertise, always welcome. Thank you.